second week of every month, we want to focus on our health. Health matters, different things that affect our body, different things that affect our mind. But with that being the case, it's also important to understand that everything we do while we occupy until Christ return should be about witnessing and bringing others to Him. So if you have a connection with Christ, then you're good. Your mission then becomes, how many other people can you connect, right? So this week we want to focus on choices. Title is The Dopamine Effect. Let's bow our heads real quick. Dear Lord, thank you so much. Speak through me now. Let it be your words, not mine. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
So what is dopamine? Slang term, dope, right? Heard that, drugs, that's back in the day. Dopamine is actually a chemical in the body, and it helps keep you emotionally balanced. Dopamine is a chemical in your brain. It affects emotions, movements, pleasure, pain, different sensations. It's released with different activities. There are neurotransmitters, and they're located deep within the brain, in the middle region, and the substantia nigra. All right, so what are the areas, and I know we're on time, so I will move through the different things that we do, but happy to ask questions at another time, answer questions at another time. So these are the different areas that are impacted, right? Cognition, desire, learning, work, sleep, motivation, behavior. The dopamine effect, too much of it, too little of it, actually impacts our behavior, who we are as people. It impacts how you interact with others. Different things can release it. You actually can't go get dopamine, right? It is something that is within your body, and different things that you do will cause it to release. And you can release more, or other things will cause you to have less, and your body will function differently based on that. The reason that dopamine is producing the different things that do that are so addictive is because when you release dopamine, the ability to do that, it actually wants you to have that again, right? So the more dopamine you have, as it gets released, it causes you to want more dopamine. That's why people that have drug addictions, which is such a pure form of a negative side of overdosing on that, it's very hard to break. It's not just, oh, I won't do that anymore. It actually, the chemical balance, imbalance, makes you want to have that more. So it's feeding itself. So the person that goes through different types of experiences from time to time will find themselves wanting to do it again and again. But that's not just negative, right? So there are things that we're going to talk about that cause dopamine to be released. There are foods that can increase your levels. I'll mention that chocolate is one of them. So for those of you that find yourself always wanting chocolate, there's a scientific reason behind that. It increases your dopamine levels, and therefore every time you eat it, when you're around it, that chemical will remind you that that makes you feel good, and you go back and get more regardless. That's how dopamine works. So I want to take a moment to look at the scripture in context and tie this to how this applies with our lifestyle. For this commandment I command you this day, too hard for you, neither is it far off. So the scripture reading that was read, and I'm going to paraphrase this. You can read it as I'm talking if you can multitask, or look up in Deuteronomy 30, verses 11 through 20 is what we're coming from. The scripture was read 15 and 16. What it's talking about is what God is saying here. He's saying this isn't too hard for you to do, right? You're going to have some choices. He's blessed us with this, this opportunity to choose. We're aware that we're going to get great controversy. And really, our life here is temporary. Everything here is temporary. There is no middle ground. There is no, this is my life, and I'm trying to decide if I'm going to live for God or live for Satan. You either are or you aren't. There is no in between. And so what it's saying is, in this commandment is, hey, this isn't too hard for you to do. It's not something that is beyond the sea and someone have to bring it to you and come back, or you have to climb up into a mountain. What I'm asking for you, you are fully capable of doing. And what God is asking us is to make a choice. He goes on to say, see, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of your Lord God that I command you today by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then ye shall live and multiply, and the Lord God will bless you in the land that you are entering and take possession of it. But if you turn your hearts away, verse 17, and you serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. Verse 19, I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose what?
Life.
That you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, holding fast to him. For he is your life and the length of your days, that you may dwell in the land of the Lord, swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, to give them. What I find interesting is that in verse 15, he says, I set before you today life and good and evil, and if you obey the commandments. And then four verses later, he says it again, basically. Every time I've read this verse, I find it interesting, because God is saying, I've set before you life and death. Then he tells us what to choose. You would think that that would be an easy choice. If I went to you and said, hey, this is going to help you live, this is going to help you die, you wouldn't expect me to tell you, have to then tell you, oh, by the way, choose the one that's going to help you live. So why does God say that? Why does God set things up in a way to make them so clear? Because we understand that will, that power of choice, if we're not connected to the right source, becomes very difficult to make. Because we're born into sin. And the chemical imbalance, the chemical balances that we have, things like dopamine that are just one aspect of the brain that controls and impacts several different things that we do. Sinners are very comfortable sinning. It's not rocket science, right? We're born with an inclination to sin. And so God is telling us, hey, you're going to have choices until I return. Everything is a choice. And so if you're not connected, if you're not tied in, then that choice becomes confusing. Something as simple as eating because you're hungry. Right? We heard a testimony that some might have heard and said, well, he was tempted to eat food. Why does he consider that a temptation? Well, he knows that he didn't share that he shared with me, is that if I eat past a certain time, then my body stays awake. And if I stay awake, then that impacts me getting up. And if it impacts me getting up, then I come to church late. So eating food isn't bad, but when you're going against an enemy that watches how you do things every way, he can place different things in front of you, and if you're not tied in, you can make choices that would be of a detriment. So I want to look at a concept called periodization. All right? So the last days are here, and I chose the little people there intentionally. They look excited, right? Because typically when you say the last days, that's followed by get your house in order, fire, brimstone. We actually don't preach a lot of those sermons anymore. It was back when I was a kid. But the interesting thing was, when I was a kid, they used to say, the end is coming. Now, I'm not that old. I know some of the younger ones think I'm extremely old. But in my short little lifetime, the message from up front has moved from the end is coming to we're living in the last days. I find that significant. So this periodization is a concept that talks about we have to understand the reality of things and our perception of things. Your perception is basically your reality. Some people take that to mean that there's actually no truth. I'm not going to get into that today. What we're talking about today is that there is a truth. God is true. The Word is true. And we understand that. But our perception of things impacts how we respond to life as we experience it. The perception is, this quote here says, if we did things we are capable of doing, we would literally astound ourselves. That's Thomas Edison. Do you understand what you're capable of achieving with a relationship of God, being fully committed to God? Do you really understand that? Our perception is that I have time to decide what type of Christian I'm going to be. The reality is, you have to choose to make certain decisions, smaller decisions, that support that choice to follow Christ every day, or it really won't have the impact it's supposed to have. See, that thing that God gave us as a choice, we can pray to Him, but God will never make us do anything. It's not that He can't. It goes against the very core of who He is. If He could make us do stuff, there's no reason to send His Son. He could have stopped all this from happening before. He could have made sure Adam and Eve didn't eat of the tree, et cetera, et cetera. We wouldn't have to go through all this. And so you wouldn't change that now simply because you want to get closer to Him. He wouldn't change now and make you get closer to Him, because that would mean all the suffering in our Earth's history before that would be for naught. Does that make sense? Follow me? All right. We mistakenly believe that there is a lot of time until Jesus returns. And we act accordingly. We act with a lack of a sense of urgency, not realizing that every week is important, every day, every moment. Every opportunity that we have with each other is a moment to grow in Christ. So in periodization, we have to see how things work, right? We are what we do. So I'm in education, I hear students all the time, Mr. Wright, I'm going to increase my grades, I'm going to study more, this and that. I always hit them with, and what is your plan? What is your plan? Because if you don't have a plan, it's just a hope and a dream. It's not a goal. Goals without plans are hopes and dreams. We get into smart planning and all that type of stuff. And I won't get into that today. But essentially, it is your thinking that drives results, right? So when you change your actions, that gives you incremental progress, incremental success. You want to stop eating. Let's say we'll take weight, health, right? We want to live a healthier life. So you change what you eat. That's bad for me. I'm going to take in less sugar. I'm not going to drink caffeine. I'm going to stay away from processed foods. You come up with that. I'm going to exercise more. All these things that you watched and you've heard, you came to HopeSide and there was some guy you didn't know talking about health, and you took a couple little nuggets back with you and decided to change your life, right? And so you see some results, right? If you take in less sugar, if you exercise more, you see some results. You know, that's called a diet. You change your diet, you see some results, and 3 months later, you're bigger than you were before you started. How did that happen? Because you slipped into other things. Why? You had incremental success, but you never really changed your way of thinking. You actually like to snack. You're okay with snacking. You just wish it didn't have the impact on you. You haven't taken time to understand what it's actually doing to your body, the things that you're putting in your body, the stuff that you're watching, where you're spending your time. So you're adjusting things to get closer to God or to live better, or I'm not going to, you know, desensitize myself with all the violence, or I'm going to get rid of my video games, or I'm not going to hang out at this restaurant or those friends. But we have to take the time to look and change our way of thinking. So if you change your actions, you have incremental improvement. But if you shift your thinking, everything changes. If you really took time to understand and be committed to the idea that Christ is soon to come, and you really bought into that, your life would live differently. That's what ties into the whole faith and works. That's why Christ was like, no, if you really love me, you'll keep the commandments. commandments. We always try to break that down to, okay, so I said I loved him, so now let me see what I have to do to change. That's actions. Christ is saying, change your thinking, understand who I am, and that will impact everything else that you do. So this thing called dopamine, increased dopamine is more productivity. So here are some things, ways to increase your levels. You can discover new things. Dopamine is actually triggered when we find new and exciting things. So I know the internet is out there, it's a very bad thing, a lot of bad on the internet. But there's also a lot of good. Things like, almost said Pinterest. It's a joke we have in our family that it's actually Pinterest, but sometimes we add extra syllables. But things on Pinterest, right, where you can learn recipes, different things like that, those are new things. And when you try new things, it releases more dopamine. List down your small tasks. Big task, small task. It's very simple, very similar to what actually causes endorphins to be released. It's not that you don't remember it. So I'm suggesting to you, this is a very practical message today, right? Make a list of the things you have to do. It has nothing to do with your memory. When you cross off things, it increases your dopamine release. The more you get done, the more you want to get things done. Let's tie that to our witness. If you have witnessing written down in your schedule, as opposed to just going out and in your common day, but you actually have a slot built in where you're going to go to witness, when you come back and mark that off, you will want to go witness again. Remember what dopamine does to you? It connects. Every time you do an activity that releases that, when it comes time for that again, it will remind you to do that activity because it wants to be released again. Exercise often. Establish a streak. Something as simple as marking off days on the calendar. You know, like little kids or X to my birthday. Something like that actually releases more dopamine. Anybody keeping a calendar marking off days until Jesus returns? Just throwing it out there. There are some foods that help release that. You have almonds, avocados, bananas, watermelons. There's some other dairy items, but my family is vegan, so in respect for them, I didn't list those things like milk and eggs and yogurt. It's a conflicting health message. But anyways, right? So what we're talking about is finding a connection, and this is easier said than done, and it takes it out of our comfort zone. What do I mean it takes it out of our comfort zone? The reason why it takes it out of our comfort zone is because sinners like to do one thing. What do sinners do? Thank you. So anytime we talk about doing things and getting connected and committed to Christ and living his agenda instead of ours, it's very uncomfortable. And even though it doesn't seem like work, it is. Right? So we've got a few more to go through, and I'll wrap up, and we'll be done. The secret to living God's potential is to value his direction in your life above your own comfort. If you find yourself lacking in passion or ministry, it's not your leadership. It's not a crisis of passion. It's a crisis of vision, right? You need a vision to be greater than your present. So when you're thinking about what you want to do, it's got to be so big that you can't do it without God. When you're thinking about where you need to be, it's got to be so big that you can't do it without God, or there's no reason to ask God to help you with it. Intentionality. Right? This takes time, and this is a practical application of what I'm talking about. So today's talk, before I close, I got to leave you with these practical things. Right? Here's a list. You need to put time in to routinely have time with God and focus on what God wants you to do. And church is not it. That's God's time. You need your time with God, right? Here's a list of things: breakout blocks, buffer blocks, strategic blocks. Interested versus committed, right? There are a lot of people that are interested in getting closer to Christ. Does that sound like a good thing? I'm interested in getting to know Jesus. I'm very interested in getting to know Jesus. It is said that the chicken is interested in breakfast, and therefore he contributes the egg. But the pig contributes the bacon and is therefore fully committed. Right? Bacon, you're in. You're breakfast. Egg, I'm interested in it. Right? When we commit to something, we do things that we have to do things we would not ordinarily do. The question of if goes away when you're committed. See, when you're interested, you have ifs, you have maybes. When you're committed, it's only how. When you're committed to living for Christ, it's only how do I do? Not, Lord, why did I lose my job? Not, Lord, why is it so hard? Not, Lord, why does it feel like you're not answering my prayers? Lord, how do you want me to deal with the fact that I got cancer? How do you want me to deal with the fact that I'm lonely? How do you want me to deal with the fact that I don't know the answer to how to raise my kids? How do you want? Because I'm committed to you, Lord. I'm committed. That's the difference. And we have to have a body that is functioning in a way that releases more dopamine with a relationship with him so that we crave him more and more and more. Does that make sense?
Amen.
Commitment is an act, not a word. There are four key successful commitments with a strong desire, keystone actions, count the cost, and act on commitments, not feelings. Keystone actions, I don't have enough time to get into. These are actions that you do that are the basis of other things, right? So a keystone action would be waking up early. So if I start my day earlier, then there's several other things that happen after that. That's a keystone action, as opposed to just keeping a list. Keeping a list, you're at the end of things. So I won't get into that too much. But number four, act on commitments and not feelings. There are several times where you don't feel good. You don't feel like coming to church. You don't feel like being nice. You don't feel like talking to God. You don't feel like following God. But if you're committed, you do it anyway. God never promised that everything down here would go our way if we choose to follow him. But if you're committed to him, you ask the how questions, not the why questions, and you make actions based on the commitment that you gave to him. Because remember, it was your choice. I'll end with this. If this is not the way you're currently living, I'm going to prep you and try and encourage you before it happens. The emotional cycle of change is real. It's scientific. This is not something out of the Bible. It's science in the world, and it's science how God made us. Science and creation go together because God created science. Amen. Right? Emotional cycle of change. This is a for real thing. All right? I'm going to walk you through this. I'll have prayer, and I'll be done. The emotional cycle of change. Phase one is informed optimism. You might walk out of today's message and say, you know what? There were some good things in there. I'm going to do this, this, and this. You feel good about it. You've gotten something. You've been equipped with some knowledge. We have a guest here from Montgomery County, Department of Health. They're going to share some things. There's a lot of things that you're going to get. Yes, this is valuable information. I'm going to make some changes. You have uninformed optimism. Then, as you start getting into it, you digest the things, right? Because just because you get information doesn't mean you really understand. So now you're starting to understand. You're unpacking it. You're reading through the brochures. You know, you're replaying the slides in your head. Now you start seeing the amount of work it's going to take. Wait a minute. For me to have devotion with God, spend time with my family, cook a nice meal for them so they don't have snacks and process everything before they go to school, I gotta wake up earlier. I don't like getting up earlier. So now you're into phase two. You start taking a dip because you start seeing the work that it takes, and now you have informed pessimism. All you have to do is accept Christ. You feel good. Get in the water. You're baptized. You come out. And now the devil starts attacking you. You start understanding the great controversy. You start understanding how good the enemy is and what he does. And now you're a little informed, and so now you get a little discouraged. You have informed pessimism, and that's phase two. You stay on that downward track because you keep grinding, but you feel like you're on your own, and it's just outside of your comfort zone. It's not something you're used to. It's a change, and nobody likes change, even if they're okay with it. I deal with change all the time. I don't like it when it happens, and most of the time as an administrator, I'm the one that's initiating it. The challenges of trying to lead a school and do things better, right? And so you hit phase three, which is the valley of despair, and this is where most people give up because it's just not worth it. I see her over there, and she looks fine. She started, she's only been doing it 2 weeks. I've been after her for 2 months. She seems happy. Everything's fine. Why can't I be like her? It must be something wrong with me. I give up. And then you go back through, you quit, and you find something else, or you come back to it again, and you go through the same two phases again. When you see people change, and you see that I used to be narcissistic, or I used to be selfish, and now I'm giving and I'm loving, it's the people that get through the valley of despair, and now they get into informed optimism. So now I'm in a place where I know what it is that I'm doing, and I see the benefits, and I've educated myself, and I've got through that hump. And now these good things that I do, of doing tasks and creating time in my week where me and the Lord just have time to pray, and I get up earlier, and I'm eating better, and I feel better, and now I've lost a couple pounds, and I can walk a little further, and my mind is more clear, and I'm not so distracted. And I see all the things that are happening. There's no way I'm going back to that, right? And then you move over to successful fulfillment of your goal. So whether you apply it to weight, whether you apply it to a vice that you want to get rid of, or what I would encourage you today is to apply it to your walk with Christ. Amen. Success and fulfillment to where you're so committed to Christ that you get more energy. You witness because every time you witness, you feel good about witnessing. You speak his love and his mercy because every time you experience it, you want to experience it more. It's not a toil and a weight and a yoke. He says, my yoke is easy. But yet many times we take it on and we conduct ourselves and carry ourselves as to who would want to be a part of that? If we have guests from the community come in here, and all we talk about is, yeah, I got through another week. Yeah, the Lord is good, but I still can't fix it. That's not a witness. You don't have energy, you don't have enough energy to stay by and go and sing for somebody or pray for somebody. You don't have enough energy to help your fellow man. Because you got a work week coming up, you don't have enough energy. Be committed to Christ and what he has laid out for you, and that's where you'll find success. So today, I leave you with this. Choose life. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you to Brother Wright for the great information. Was that deep? The Sabbath school lesson was about what? Be deeply involved in love and all that. So thank you for the great pointers. And now we know how we can be involved in practice of informed optimism. That means as we do things, not based on feelings, but on commitment, that it becomes much more enjoyable. And now I would like to introduce Sister Huyen Wing. She goes by the word by the Anglicized name, Wing. She's from the Montgomery Department of Health. Now she will share about the community health services and resources that are available. And I think they're truly helpful for us. And if you know anyone, please contact us. There's some information on the table over there. And now I would like to invite Ewan to come and share. And as I said last month, and the second week, Christians should be known for what? Caring without limits. Caring for your health. Caring for, you know, the people around us. Caring for your faith without limits. And then willing to go out and witness. Now, I would like to ask her to come here. Would you like to come here or no? Yeah, okay.
Hi, everyone. Hello. So, again, you can call me Wing. Wing Bui, and I'm with the Asian American Health Initiative of Montgomery County's Department of Health and Human Services. I know that's kind of a mouthful. I am the resource coordinator, so I deal a lot with the community members directly. I help them get access to the different services that are available, and I walk them through the process of applying and setting up appointments and pretty much navigating the system, which for a lot of people, I understand it's very complicated sometimes. So hopefully some of the information I provide today will be helpful, and I'm always available to answer any questions you may have. And I have a few packets here that I'd like everybody to have and maybe follow along with me as I go through the presentation. And I'll try to be brief because I'm sure everyone wants to enjoy the rest of the weekend. So, okay. So I'll be giving a brief overview of what our organization does, the Asian American Health Initiative, and then I'll go into the different parts that fall under the Department of Health and Human Services. And then I'll give a couple of different resources where you can access a lot of the information that I mentioned today. So, AHI, our mission is to reach out to the Asian American population in the county. And through that, we aim to identify the healthcare needs of this population and to provide cultural and language specific services for these people and to make all of these resources accessible and available. And so the Asian Americans in Montgomery County make up 14.7%. And there are actually five common subgroups of Asian Americans. Can anybody guess what they are? Anyone want to take a shot at that? Don't be shy.
Chinese, Koreans, Vietnamese, Indians.
Good job.
Well, I saw the slide.
Okay, so Andy was correct. So Chinese Americans make up the majority, and then following that are Asian Indians, Koreans, Vietnamese, and Filipino. And then the other includes other ethnic subgroups. So for this reason, the fact that there is such a diverse range of Asian Americans, our organization does a lot of outreach in the community. So that includes attending over 40 different health events, such as health fairs and cultural celebrations throughout the year. And we reach over 1,000 community members each year doing so. We focus on the health issues that mostly affect Asians. And so we provide health education materials and screenings based on those needs. So that includes cancer, hepatitis B, heart health, and mental health education. So of course, all of these health issues affect everyone equally, but particularly in the Asian American community, these are those that affect this population the most. So you see some of our volunteers here, they are giving a bone density screening for osteoporosis. And generally we have this education table set up as well in that top picture. And so within your folders, you actually have our fact sheet, so you can read a little bit more about our organization and the various programming that we do in addition to outreach. And so now I want to jump into the county's Department of Health and Human Services. So before I get into that, I just wanted to make a statement that despite what may be going on in the political realms of our country, Montgomery County is still a welcoming community, and based on what I know and that what we've been told is that all the county services are still being dealt the same way. So the requirements that an individual or family has to have to be eligible for the service is still necessarily the same. So it's pretty much just based on the fact that you live in Montgomery County, you fall under a certain income bracket, and sometimes your age. But aside from that, we don't discriminate based on whether you are here legally or illegally. And so just want to say that we are still very welcoming to people for accessing our services. So in your folders, you actually have a yellow piece of paper, and it's a little different from this chart here, but it's sharing similar information. So this top left square here, this is where our organization falls under within the department. So we are under the Office of Community Affairs, and we are one of three diversity health initiatives, including the Latino Health Initiative and the African American Health Program. So they do similar work where they focus particularly with those of ethnic groups, and they provide health programming, and they also do outreach events in the community. So now I'm gonna go over these five service areas, is what we call them. And so on your chart, it's probably the blocks in the middle. So first, I would like to start with the aging and disability services. So under this service area, they provide programs for the older adult population, as well as people with disabilities and caregivers who provide services to these populations. And so one notable contact that I would like you guys to remember is the Aging and Disability Resource Unit. So their number is 240-777-3000. And this number you can call and you can get information on all of the different services that are available. So such as nutrition programming for older adults, senior transportation, any kinds of medical needs, and you know, caregiving needs, then you can call this number and they will provide you information and referrals and how to apply to these services. So in my experience, they are very helpful, and generally when I call, I usually have to leave a message, but they get back to you pretty quickly, so within 1 to 2 business days. So they're very quick and convenient, and you might want to prepare some of the some information that they might ask, such as, you know, proof of residency, proof of income, and your age. So if you happen to go in for an appointment, they might ask you to bring some of these documents for proof. Does anyone have any questions so far? Sorry if I'm speaking fast, but okay. So the next service area is Behavioral Health and Crisis Services. So this service area deals all with behavioral and mental health needs, as well as substance abuse needs for an individual or family. And so one overarching program that, again, I believe it would be helpful for everyone to remember is access to behavioral health. So this program, they actually provide free over-the-phone and in-person screenings and assessments for individuals who may feel like they may be suffering from a mental health issue or substance abuse issue. And they just ask that for any in-person needs or any in-person direct services that you be uninsured or have Medicare or Medicaid. And of course that you live in Montgomery County to access the service. So there's a couple ways that you can go about contacting them. So it could be over the phone. So this is their phone number here and their hours of operation. And so once you call someone on the phone, it'll probably be a therapist or a social worker. They'll do a quick needs or assessment, and then if you're eligible, you can go in for a consultation, and then they'll provide you further referral or assistance if needed. Or you can actually go in person to their office, and here are their office hours for walk-ins, and you can actually meet with somebody, and again, they'll go through the process of doing an assessment, and then the screening, and then a referral if needed for any services that may be ongoing. So the third service area is the Children, Youth, and Family Services. And so this branch focuses on programming for healthy and safe development of children and their families. So that includes programs such as child welfare and temporary cash assistance and the supplemental nutritional program, or better known as food stamps, that all falls under this service area. And then there's the public health services programming, which offers the dental programs, the cancer screening programs, immunization programs, and healthcare clinics. So I'll go through a few of those more in detail because these are the most commonly asked based on my experience in the communities. So there's actually two dental programs. So it's for the senior maternity and children, and then there's a separate program for adults. So for senior maternity and children, it offers general basic dental care, such as, you know, cleanings and any sort of restorative care like fillings. And you must be between like these age groups. And they do charge a $20 copay for every visit or $30 for any emergency visits. And so in order to apply, you must first go to what we call the Office of Eligibility and Support Services. So here they will ask you to bring the documents that I mentioned earlier. So, you know, proof of residency in the county, proof of age and income. And those offices are located in three different regions of the county. And if you're approved, they will actually mail you a certification letter, and then the dental program will help you schedule an appointment at one of the four clinics. And then they ask that once you are scheduled an appointment and you're going to visit for an appointment, that you bring the certification letter with you and a photo ID, and they'll have you actually fill out additional forms such as medical history. And as I mentioned, there's some cancer programs that provide free cancer screenings for those who are eligible. So usually it's for those who are low income and do not have health insurance. They can be eligible for the Women's Cancer Control, which offers free mammograms and cervical cancer screenings. And then there's the colorectal cancer screening, which for those 50 and over with no current diagnosis of colon cancer, you can get a free screening for that as well. And then, by the way, all this can be found on the blue brochure that's in your folders. So on the back, you'll see the Montgomery Cares clinics listed. And these clinics provide basic medical care to those who, again, do not have health insurance or who are low income, or most of the clinics actually don't check the legal status of an individual. And so there's, I believe, 12 different clinics that any community member can have access to. And then lastly, there's special needs housing, which, as it states in the name, is for housing needs for those who may be homeless or who may need assistance paying for their rental bills and utility bills and any sort of affordable housing options for individuals and families. Special needs housing would be the branch that you would contact. And so kind of just to wrap everything up into some of what I've mentioned here, that resource brochure, that blue one that I included in your folders, it's actually available on our website for download in 15 Asian languages. If you know anyone who might benefit from this information and from the county programs, I would recommend that you share this. And if you'd like extra copies, I actually brought some with me, so feel free to ask me afterwards. But again, the back side there shows the clinic information. And then on the front side also has our contact information and our website. And then lastly, there's the MC311 phone line. Has anyone used this before or heard of MC311? Okay, so do you mind me asking what you called for?
I've heard of it.
You've heard of it?
Get it done.
Get it done? So yeah, that, there's their slogan, call 311, get it done. Have you used it before?
I have 311, I use it for coordinating the trash pickup.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So that's the great thing about this phone line is that they don't just refer you to government information, but it's also non-government related. So for example, yes, like trash pickup or snow removal, or as you see in this picture, if there's a pothole that you want to report, they can take care of that service. But also they can be a guiding point for you to any government related services as well. So you can either call them 311, or if you're calling from outside of the county, you actually have to dial out the 10-digit phone number. Or they actually have a website where you can do similar things like place a service request and access the different program information. So that's it for me. Are there any questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah. If I understand clearly what you were saying, you were actually saying that no one is actually being denied services, regardless if you belong to Montgomery County or you are you don't have a status, right, and status here. So people who don't have a proper status here, that means everything will be coming out of pocket. Money to pay for services.
So, can you guys hear me without the mic?
Yeah.
Can you hear me back there, ma'am?
Yes.
Great. Okay. So, depending on the program, so a lot of the programs have different, well, minor different criteria that they require somebody to fall under to get their service. So, for example, for the Montgomery Cares clinics, the list of the 12, they mostly just ask for proof that you live in this county. I know maybe two or three of them actually provide services to other residents in other counties or even visitors to the United States. But overall, they don't exactly ask you for documentation that you live here, you know, documented, undocumented. So that's what I meant with that, with the clinics. With the other programs, again, they usually require that you just live in the county and that you fall under a certain income bracket. So.
Yeah, but that means they will not be able to benefit from the, whether a resident in the county will benefit from financially. That means they'll have to pay for some services.
So, even if you do live in the county, you still have to pay some. So for the clinics, they charge a copay, but that's the fee that you pay for the service. So depending on your income, it could be between like $20 to like $120, I believe. But that's what you're paying just for that service instead of receiving a bill afterwards for any additional expenses. Because again, those are for people who don't have insurance, so they don't really, they can't really bill anybody else to help you pay, so you're pretty much just paying that copay up front. So even for county residents, you still have to pay a little out of pocket. Like the dental program, you still have to pay a copay, and it's more so for like the cancer screening, they provide you a voucher that covers that service. And then for like rental assistance and utility bill assistance, based on your income again, they'll provide you like a stipend to help cover part of your bill. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yes, sir.
Is the funding for this come, does the funding for this come out of the county Medicaid system?
The Medicaid system? No. So Medicaid is a different program in itself. So that's for health insurance for those who have low income. So we use it interchangeably with Medicaid and medical assistance. And that's a state-run program, Medicaid. So each state has their own Medicaid programming and Medicaid funds. But a lot of these either discounted or free services, they are funded through the county, most of them through the county, and some of them through the state as well. So like the energy and utility bill assistance, that's through the state, but then all the other ones are through the county. So again, each county would have their own funding for programming or not. So I know PG County and Howard County, they don't have too much of what we have here in Montgomery County. They have a few. I think Howard County has the cancer programs, and PG County has like senior transportation. But yeah, those are more county based.
Yeah, I want to congratulate you or maybe applaud what you said very bravely, that this program is for documented and undocumented people. Because in a research I studied, research is saying a lot about especially one population, the Latino population, that have had a disparity on health needs. And one of the reasons is because some of the individuals that are undocumented did not go for services because they were afraid they would be asked of their IDs. So I'm hoping that what you're saying now is loud and stressed out, you know, to individuals who are not documented, because these individuals could end up in the ER, costing the hospital and the government a lot more if they don't get implemented measures, you know, of that.
Well, thank you for that. I think that there's a certain fear that people have at this moment that, you know, they can't ask for help. They can't reach out and ask us for help. though we are here for you. You know, and so that's kind of the message that we try to give by going to outreach so much. We go into different faith communities, different community-based organizations, just so that we can say, you're not alone. And I've actually worked, so again, I work directly with the community members, sort of like a social worker, and there have been a couple people who come in to our office and have said, you know, I'm waiting on a green card, or I'm just here visiting, but, you know, everyone's different, everyone's different statuses, but our whole thing is that we're here to help you, and it's all very confidential. So anything that you say stays within our office, within our county, and we won't discriminate against you and not provide you the services that you need, because our whole mission is to, you know, target those who have health needs and provide them a service. So as long as we're doing that, then, you know, nothing else should.
But also, your call centers, do they have like bilingual interpreters to answer, other than just the commonly, you know, bilinguals? Because there are, you know, if you just reach out to Asians, there are too many Asian dialects.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody might be very urgent to get care, but they just can't communicate, and they're afraid to get somebody else to go to them.
Yes. Thank you. That's actually a very important point that I forgot to bring up. So all the Montgomery County programs are required to use what we call a language line. So I believe in this county there's over 160 or 200 languages spoken. And so this language line helps to break down that barrier of those who are not English proficient. So any of these county programs you call, or that they're required to use interpretation. So it goes beyond Asian languages. It goes beyond the Latino language. It's again addressing those over 100 languages spoken. So what you just have to call and say, you know, I need Chinese, or I need French. And then also, I mentioned that we're one of three diversity health initiatives. So there's the African American Health Program. And I know their staff speak a few different languages, including French and Creole and Amharic. I might be missing a few, but again, we're here to address, to break down those barriers that exist, language-wise and cultural-wise. So, thank you. Any other questions? I believe I included my business card in the folder as well. So you have a direct
contact.
Just
one final question. What does the county do for the homeless? You know, you see, and sometimes you do see the homeless inclusive of people who may not have immigration or whatever, but similarly, people who are residents and are still, you know, poverty stricken, and they need help. What do you actually do? Because we see a lot of groups in different locations, and there are millions of pacifiers that don't even do anything, but I'm sure the county has eyes and ears, so what do they do?
So, because I don't work directly with the special needs housing service area, I can't tell you exactly what they do in terms of outreach and daily functioning, but I know that there are services out there for homeless individuals. There's a lot of faith communities that provide shelter, food. There's housing programs specifically for those who can't afford housing. I think a reoccurring pattern that I notice is the underutilization of services. Just because, it could be for a variety of reasons, but mainly because there's a lack of knowledge of the services that exist. So the fact that these homeless individuals may not have access to computers or access to different in community centers that provide this information, they may not know how to get that help. So again, it could be for a variety of reasons, and I can't exactly give you a direct answer.
The worrisome factor is that the homeless, they go out to the public, they all go out to the county, and they have a small wooden board that emphasizes their need. So here they are, maybe in rain and drizzle, and maybe in some of the snow, standing out there, and they're going, they're reaching out to the public. While you have a county with air conditioning and heat, and individuals go there, you know, all that stuff, they are there to think about these people that are in need, you know, to make sure that at least, you know, they can get them off that cold or get them off that drizzly rain and help them out. You can see them standing there through the rain, but and again, it's not your area, so I shouldn't talk to you about this. But they come with the homeless umbrella, but they are actually a combination of psychological, mental illness, poverty-strickenness, homelessness, depression, various things. So that's one of my passions. If I had that money to open an institution or get a grant to work with that.
Well, if you'd like to get in touch with someone within that area, the special needs housing, I'd be more than happy to get your information and pass it along. And you can ask them directly, you know, what they do and what kind of programming that exists. And if you are aware of a lot of homeless populations in certain areas, I'm sure they would love to hear from you.
Yeah, in fact, we have an abbotess who just elected, Dr. Ben Carson, for the bigger of the homeless.
Right.
And I'm sure Arnold has his numbers.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, everyone.
Dear Lord, we thank you for another opportunity to come together and worship you. Lord, I ask that you be with Ms. Nguyen and efforts of the county to reach out to your children that find themselves less fortunate for a variety of different reasons. Lord, be with us as well as partners in their efforts and partners with you as we come in contact with people. Help our lives to be a light, a model of connection to you so that people feel encouraged with a word or with funding or with a home or with food. Impress upon our hearts and minds as we leave here today to be more observant of the world around us, and then equip us with whatever we need to make that person's life better and drive them to you. Take care of us through the week. Bless us and keep us. Save us in your kingdom when you return. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.